Vagishadhyasamanasahasatvarthanamupakrame Yamnatvakritakatyasyuhutam namamigajananam Sadashivasamarambham Shankaracharyamadhyamam Asmadacharyapadyantam Vande Guruparamparam Yoginam Vishwanathakyam Asmattatasvarupinam Atmalabhatparamlabham Vaktaram Nakadachana Gitaarthagrantakattaram Sri Gurum Pranamamyaham Yuntah Pravishyamevacham Dhritim Buddhim Prachodayat Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yathkripatamaham Mande Paramananda Madhavam Om Namah Sabhabhya Sabhapati Bhyascha O Namaham. Friends, we are now in the 12th session of Gita Regimen for Advaitic Living. We are in shloka number 64 of chapter 2. Today you will need to have the book with you because I am going to refer to certain shlokas even beyond the second chapter. Anyway, shloka number 64. Ragadveshaviyuktaistu Vishayan Indriyaischaran Atmavasyair Videyatma Prasadam Adigachati. According to me, this is the most important shloka among the 18 shlokas that Krishna talks from shloka 55 onwards in reply to Arjuna's question. What was Arjuna's question? How does a sthita prajna behave? How does he walk? What is his language? Can you tell me any outward signs about how he behaves? Krishna is going to say, "Arey bhai, there are no outward signs." You will understand it presently. But so far, Krishna has been answering Arjuna's question, but he is answering them only in a general way, by giving definitions of sthita prajna, and then telling how indriya nigraha is difficult, and so on. You see, how does a sthita prajna behave? You see, he has not yet said. He is going to tell you now. This is the direct answer to Arjuna's question. So what is the direct answer? Ragadveshaviyuktaistu Vishayan Indriyais Charan. Charan is the key word. What is Charan? Moving about. Moving about. You see, Arjuna asks, how does he move about? How does he behave? Aray, this is how he behaves. How? Charan. Vishayane Indriyaihi Charanne. Vishayan, the objects. The sense objects. Indriyaihi, by the senses. So, he is moving about the senses, sense objects, with his senses, in the same way, just as you and I behave. There are, you see, Arjuna has been asking for outward signs. So here he says, he moves the Brahmajnani, the sthita prajna. We will use the word sthita prajna hereafter. You understand that. A man, a person who has reached his destination, he is a confirmed wisdom. His wisdom is anchored to the self. Self with a capital S. So that person, he is the sthita prajna. Sthita means anchored. Prajna means intelligence. Anchored intelligence. His intelligence does not go anywhere outside the self. There is nothing outside the self for him. So then, he, Vishayane Indriyaihi Charan, he moves about the sense objects with his senses in the same way as anybody moves, but with a slight exception. His attitude is different. Ragat Dvesha Vyuktaihi Indriyaihi. Indriyaihi, he is also allowing his senses to interact with the sense objects, just as your senses interact with the sense objects. But that interaction has a tremendous subjective change in it, which you cannot see outside. Ragadvesha Viyuktai. That is the key word here. What is Ragadvesha Viyuktai? Raga is attachment. Dvesha is hate. So like, dislike, raga is like, dvesha is dislike, likes and dislikes, right? Like and dislike. Vyuktai, devoid of, he has no likes, he has no dislikes, he has no attachment, he has no hate. So there is nothing which he wants, there is nothing which he does not want. Raga dvesha vyuktai. This is a subjective change. You see, the previous shlokas only define a sthita prajna. Here he tells you how to move about. You have to move about, you have to walk, you have to have your daily duties, you have to do your office work, you have to discharge your obligations, you have to do everything. But raga dvesha vyuktai. That's what. So this is the direct answer to Arjuna's question. This is the regimen for us. This is the regimen. You have to write raga dvesha vyuktai. I told you earlier, Vitaragavaya krodha means raga, attachment, fear and anger should be gone, such a person. So in order to get to that, you have to make efforts right now. Start raga dvesha vyuktai. That is, this is how you have to move about. You have to sleep, you have to walk, you have to sleep like everybody else, walk like everybody else, do your office duties like everybody else, everything. But the indriyaihi, the senses, must be atmavashyaihi. Atmavashyair vidheyatma. Atmavashyair means the senses, in atmavashyaihi governs the word indriyaihi. Second line, raga dvesha vyuktaistu vishayan indriyaischaram atmavashyai. This atmavashyai go with indriyai. Atmavashyai indriyai means the senses which are in the control of the self. Yourself, you must have, that is, this person has, is in total control of the senses. Those senses are interacting with the sense objects with raga dvesha vyuktai, devoid of raga and dvesha. This is the most important thing. Such a person, prasadam adigacchati, he reaches the final grace, consciousness or whatever. Prasadam. We will come to the word prasadam a little later. So now we have to look at this situation. So the answer to Arjuna's question is, there is no external sign of a sthita prajna. You cannot recognize him by looking at his dress, looking at his way, things. He has to look into his mind. So it is all subjective. It is internal. So we have to have the indriya, the senses, in the control of the self. So I have to talk about the senses, the and the channels of the mind. Just now in the earlier lecture, I told you about the 16 channels of the mind. We will talk a little more elaborately about them. Now, because how to do this? How to be ragadvesha vyuktai? What happens? You see, among the 16 channels, 13 are bad. That is why I call them gang of 13. Gang of 13. Krishna helps me by giving me a word somewhere in a later chapter. Indriyagramam. He calls it Indriyagramam, I think in the 6th chapter. Indriyagramam means gang of 13. Gang of the Indriyas. So this is a gang. Out of them, ego, ahankara, is the captain. There are 12 of them. The 12 I group in the following way. That is, raga is at the base of all these 12. Of course, ego is the captain. Raga is attachment, fondness, affection, everything, raga. So raga is the base of the 12. There is an external raga and the internal raga. What is an external attachment? I am fond of or attached to external things. Like external things, outside of me. Internal raga is attached to something inside. Body, mind, intellect, myself, my fame, my name, whatever. So that is internal raga. There is an external raga. raga, external raga, is the basis for, you understand what is external raga? External raga is an attachment towards something which is outside of you. So external raga is the basis of dvesha, hate. I don't like that man, dislike. You see, there is an external attachment towards something which makes you dislike that person. So external raga is the basis for dvesha, kama, krodha, lobha. Kama is desire, krodha is anger, lobha is greed. These are all coming from external raga. Internal raga is the basis for 5 things. Mother, arrogance. See, this has nothing external here. Yeah, I am so fond of myself. Arrogant. Matsarya, envy. Right? Envy. Irsha. What is Irsha? Irsha is a self-pity. Self-pity in the sense, why does this thing happen to me alone? Why does it not happen to anybody else? Why is me? Why me? Why me? See, when unhappiness comes, everybody has used this expression. Why me? Why does this happen to me? As if he is very great. When it can happen to anybody. So this is called Irsha. I don't find any English for it. Asuya. Asuya is malice. It will not brook the other man growing up. It will always try to talk ill of the other man. And Dambha. Dambha is kind of pride. Shall I say? No, show. Show. Show of myself. You see? You donate something and you want to write your name on that. So that is all Dambha. Right? So this is Mada Matsadya, Irsha, Asuya, Dambam. Earlier I said external raga is the basis of dvesha, kama, krodha, lobha. 4 are there. Internal raga is the basis for Mada Matsadya, Irsha, Asuya, Dambha. 5 of them. So 4 plus 5 is 9. And raga itself is 10. But raga of both kinds is a basis for 2 more. Garva and moha. Garva is false sense of pride, false sense of greatness. Moha is delusion, confusion. So there are 12 of them, including raga, and ego is the captain. Shraddha and bhakti are the 2 good channels. Ichha is neutral, as I told you. Now the tall order is to make this Ichha go only towards Shraddha and Bhakti and to avoid the Raga, Dvesha, Kama, Krodha, all those things. This is the tall order, of course. But there's no other way. This is the only way. Raga, Dvesha, Vyukta is to. So Raga and Dvesha has to be. That is the like and dislike, attachment and hate, fondness and hate. This has to be avoided. Here we have to make efforts. Atma vasyairvide atma prasodam adigacchati. When you do this kind of ragadvesha yuktaihi, nothing will affect you. No sin will attach to you. Nothing will affect you. Later we are going to talk about karta and akarta. How you are not the doer of anything. So first of all, you have to get rid of the raga and dvesha by slowly, slowly. You see, start with simple point. Somebody insults you. Somebody insults me. And I feel hurt. I feel hurt. So this is where we have to start. You see, what has he insulted? Has he insulted me, the absolute within me? No. He has insulted only either the body or the mind or the intellect or my property or my fame or my work or my speech, whatever. You see, all these things are not me. This has to come. That is why the aham brahmasmi attitude we have to repeat to ourselves very often. I am reminded of a very interesting story here. It's a concocted story, of course, but it is about Krishna and Durvasa. It's very educative. Advaiting. It teaches you Advaita. How does he do that? The gopis, you know, the cowherdesses, they were so fond of Krishna, so they come to him very often. And then he has his lots of wives there, we know that. Now, they come to Krishna and ask him, Lord, we want to go to the other side of the Yamuna. Durvasa is camping there. We want to host him. And he says yes. It's a kind of a good thing to do. So Krishna says, agree, go ahead. So they say, we are not able to cross the Yamuna because Yamuna is in floods. How do we cross it? Oh, that's the point. I will give you a mantra. You recite it and go there. I will tell you the mantra a little later. So they use the mantra and they go there. Yamuna gives way. They are able to walk over. That's it. Durvasa was there. Durvasa is 100 shishyas. So they host him. They satisfy Durvasa and his all the company. It's all over. So now they have to return. They try to return with the same mantra, but it doesn't help. So they go to Durvasa. Remember, don't underestimate Durvasa. Durvasa is a great sage. When he curses somebody, he curses it because of God's will. It is that man's fate and God's will. So Durvasa is only an instrument in the hands of God. So Durvasa is a great sage, well-known, realized soul. So he's also equally great as Krishna. So what happens? So they ask Durvasa, Swami, we came here, we entertained you, but now we are not able to go back. Why? Because Yamuna is in floods. It's not giving way. How did you come here? He asks. They say, Krishna, the Lord gave us a mantra. And that mantra, what is that mantra he gave? So they say, Krishna Nitya Brahmachari. So Krishna Nitya Brahmachari. This is the mantra we use. Krishna, the Lord said, you must be convinced about it and come. And we use the mantra, we came. Durvasa understood the trick. Durvasa said, all right, I will now give you the mantra. Durvasaha Nityopavasi. You understand what is Krishna Nitya Brahmachari? He is an eternal Brahmachari. You know the fun of it. Krishna Nitya Brahmachari, by a common sense understanding, would not mean anything. When he had 60,000 wives, and what is the meaning of saying he is Nitya Brahmachari? Again, Durvasa says, Durvasaha Nityopavasi, eternal fasting. He has just now had his very great dinner with all the gopis which they gave. So, Nityopavasi, what's the meaning of that? These two mantras, what is the meaning? This is the substance, essential content of this Ragadvesha Vyuktai. What does it mean? You see, Krishna had 60,000 wives already. After the Mahabharata war, it took only 18 days. But before and after, he had to stay. Before, he had to stay for going forth and taking messages here and there. And afterwards, he had to stay to sort out various things, take Yudhishthira to Bhishma and get him learn all the lessons. And then that Ashwatthama using the Brahmastra, etc. Krishna had to save the child in the womb of Uttara. All those things are there. So, altogether, Krishna was absent from Dwaraka for 2 months or so, probably. And so when he went back, he is now going back to his palace. 60,000 wives. He enters the house of everybody, and Bhagavatam says, every one of them thought that Krishna had come only to their house. Nothing mattered to Krishna. He was completely identified with his self. He was not touched by anything that happens to his body. This you and I cannot understand very easily, but that is what it is. That is how Krishna is Nitya Brahmachari. Similarly, the same thing with Durvasa. Durvasa Nityopavasi Raga Dvesha Vyuktai. If you are totally devoid of Raga and Dvesha, the action will not touch you. The action, whatever action you are doing, will not touch you. This is the lesson of that story. Of course, it is a very difficult story to understand and comprehend, particularly those who have not been brought up in an Indian culture or any of the Indian religious things would not be able to understand. It would be very difficult for any modern person, but that is it. Now, this shloka, as I said, is the central shloka in all these 18, Krishna's answer to Arjuna. The Bhagavad Gita emphasizes the raga dvesha. As I told you, this is the regimen for us to make efforts. Every little act of ours, we have to see whether it comes under raga, comes under dvesha. One of that it will come. Because raga is the basis for all, I told you, internal raga is the basis for something, external raga is the basis for something, and these 12 channels of the mind, some of them, all of them we are having, so we can easily identify each action of us as either influenced by raga or influenced by dosha, like and dislike. Therefore, the Gita emphasizes the avoidance of this like and dislike throughout the Gita, particularly in the following shlokas. This is where I would like you to turn over the pages of the Gita and mark them. Chapter 3, 34. Indriyasya indriyasya arthe ragadvesho vyavasthitau tayornavasamagachete tauhyasya paripanthino. In the third chapter, shloka number 34, very clearly, Gita, Krishna says, Indriyasya Indriyasya Arthe, the senses are going after the sense objects, Ragat Dveshav Yavastitav. Because of the sense objects, the senses are anchored in Raga and Dvesha. Tayorna Vashamagachete, Tauhyasya Paripantino, they are your greatest enemies. Raga and Dvesha are the greatest enemies. Again in Shloka 37, of chapter 3, when Arjuna asks, what is it that makes a man do wrong? Why is not everybody doing the right thing? And Krishna answers, Kamayesha Krodayesha Rajo Guna Samadbhavaha Mahashano Mahapapma Vidyenam Yikavairinam. Kama and Krodha. Kama is desire from attachment. Krodha is anger from that hate, dvesha. So, Kama and Krodha are byproducts of raga and dvesha. Kama yesha, krodha yesha, rajo guna samudbhavaha. From rajo guna they come. Kama and krodha, they are your enemies. They are mahashano mahapapma. They are great consumers in the sense that they devour everything. They devour you, your property, your everything. So, vidhyenam iha vairinam. Consider them as your greatest enemies. Go to the fourth chapter. In fourth chapter, 10th shloka. Vidaraga bhaya krodha manmaya mamupasthitaha bhagavogjana tapasaha puta madbhava magataha. Vidaraga bhaya krodha, raga bhaya krodha, the devoid of great people. So he is describing great people and he talked about vidaraga bhaya krodha. They are the ones who come to me. And in chapter 5, shloka 23, Shaknoti gaivayasodum praksharira vimokshanath kamakrodot bhavam vegam. So, Shaknoti gaivayasodum, whoever bears, you see, manages here, right in this word, prakshareera vimokshana, before he leaves the body. Kamakrodot bhavam vegam, that is the force, the influence, the urge that arises out of kama and krodha. He is the one, sayukta sasuke naraka, he is the one who will be happy, who is the yogi. Again in 5:28, yatendriya mano buddhihe unir moksha parayana vigatechcha bayakrodaga yasada muktaye vasaga vigatechcha bayakrodaga. Icha baya krodha, icha is raga, baya krodha, raga baya krodha. Once unless you are devoid of it, you see, yatendriya. So here he is talking about the meditation that is going to be talked about in the next chapter. So 5:28. 7. Chapter 7. Shloka 27. Icha dvesha samuttene dvandva mohena bharata sarva bhautani sammoham sarge yanti parantapa. Everybody. You see, the Christianity talks about original sin. You see, original sin of Adam and Eve, and then they talk about it. But Hinduism says, Ichadvesha samuttene, dvandva mohena bharate. By the confusion of duality, dvandva mohena, Ichadvesha samuttene. Icha is desire, dvesha is hate, desire and hate, this ragadvesha. By the combination of this, Ichadvesha samuttene, dvandva mohena bharate, the delusion of duality happens because of your being affected by raga and dvesha. So, Icha dvesha samuttena dvandva mohena bharata sarva bhutani sammoham. All beings at the start, when they start, not only this life, but wherever they started, they have started with this because of the dvandva moha, the delusion of duality, which arises because of Icha Dvesha, by a combination of like and dislike. Buddhya Abhishek, then at the last chapter, 18th chapter, when he summarizes everything, he has done so many things, you are going to see that. When he has done so many things, finally he summarizes. Even when he summarizes, he is not leaving this. Buddhya Abhishuddhaya Yukto Dhrityatmanam Nisham Yache Ragadvesho Vyadasyache. Raga dvesha yudasyaja. He is emphasizing this. Raga dvesha. He has to eradicate this. And then ahankaram balam darpam kamam krodham parigraham vimuchya nirmamashanta. So again in the next 53rd shloka he says ahankara bala darpa arrogance kamam krodham parigraham, the sense of possession, all these things have to be discarded. So you can see how important it is to have the ragadvesha viyuktai indriyai. Mark this shloka as very important and take it as your most important regimen. And therefore, prasadam adigacchati. What is prasada? Prasada is grace. There are, you know, different commentators talk. So Radha Krishna says this is peace, happiness, prasade. So the next shloka says prasade sarva dukkhanam hanirasyopajayate. When this prasada, when that blessing, grace, the realization comes, sarva dukkhanam hanihi, all unhappiness is gone. Asya upajayate prasanna chetaso hyashu. Once the mind has got this prasanna, this enlightenment. So prasada can be translated as enlightenment. Prasanna chetaso hyashu. Ashu means quickly, immediately. Buddhir paryavatishtate, the intelligence anchors itself on all sides. This is the conclusion of the ragadvesha viyuktai situation. And that is where we are going to stop. And then in the next session, we will be able to complete the second chapter. Swasti prajabhya paripalayantam yayena margena mahim mahishoha gobrahmanibhya shubhamastu nityam lokasamastas sukhino bhavantu.